Now then, let's have a look at the movie that has everyone buzzing around the Transformers franchise. There are some who thinks it's overrated and maybe terrible and such. Others think it's the best Transformers in recent years, and especially without the human element. Even has similar elements to those in days in the past. And honestly, in my experience, I can see why people put in such high regards and why it's so popular. So let's get started then, shall we? Till all are one. Autobots, Decepticons, roll out! Honestly, I thought the cast did pretty well. Ah, my friends. At last, the main event, we are here. And for sure, the intro and the videos, you got the deal. Now let's begin. Transformers 1. That came out this year. An American animated science fiction action movie based on Hasbro's Transformer Toys line. It's directed by Josh Cullen, from a screenplay by Eric Peterson, and the writing duo of Andrew Bernd and Gabriel Ferrari, I think, based on a story by both Bernd and Ferrari. I know half of these actors and actresses who played in this: Chris Hemsworth, Scarlett Johansson. Steve, I'm not sure I can spell this one, but I'll get to him soon. And KG Michael Key. But I'm sure you recognize the last two I mentioned, Chris Hemsworth and Scarlett Johansson. Do you recognize the one who played in the MCU universe of four and God knows how many other movies? You don't recognize the beautiful Johansson when she, and her lovely voice of singing? I sure remember them. It says here it is set on Cybertron, the home planet of the Transformers, and the scripts, and it tells the story and origins about the Transformers and the early relationships between Orion's Pax and D16, or in this case, Megatron. Let's see. Now let's see how this one was forged before we get to the actors, cast, crew. Productions, please. About 10 years ago, following the release of Transformers: Age of Extinction, Paramount Pictures tasked Henry Goldman in March 2015 to work with the film franchise director Michael Bay and exclusive producer Dr. Steve Spielberg and producer to set up a writer's room to create new ideas for future Transformer films. According to Goldsman, the writing team would look at various Transformer media created by Hasbro for inspiration. If they found one that interests them, they could submit a treatment which would be then be further developed by the whole team. In late May, the team of Andrew Bernard and Gabriel Ferrari signed on as writers. According to Hollywood, the Deadline Hollywood, one of the ideas from the writers' room had the working title Transformers 1 and would serve as an animation prequel focusing on the Autobot and Decepticon conflict that began on Cybertron. I see. In August 2017, it was reported that an animated Transformers film was officially announced in the works following the release of Bumblebee that came out a year later. I don't know who this one is, but he said he discussed the animation film, clarifying that it was in the works and would tell the whole Cybertron mythology. Bumblebee director Travis Knight apparently expressed an interest in the film. Interesting. So this was being spoke about for weeks to months, and that it was reported that former Pixar animator and filmmaker Josh Cullen has been hired to direct the film and was overseeing the script by both these people, even Rabanne and Friari. Hasbro Entertainment and Paramount Animation would produce the film, and in February of 2 years ago, it alerted that the film would be computer animated. In December, the title was reported to be Transformers: A New Generation, though it was later stated by the other one in April of last year that the title has yet to be finalized. Later that month, most likely in May, at CinemaCon, the title was officially confirmed as Transformers 1. And let's see, it stated that the plot will center around the origins of the Transformers. Guess I was right about that part. And explore the events that led to Optimus and Megatron to go from being brothers in arms to becoming enemies. The budget was reportedly about $75 million, although one source put the cost of production as high as $147 million. Looks like it took a lot of writing works, motions, etc., etc. And here's the big thing. They even centered out about the relation and the writing work as well, especially between the relationship between Optimus and Megatron, and the tragedy they're falling out is the emotional core of the film, which for Cullen, it was important to show that Megatron was not just a villain. He wanted people who had no knowledge of the Transformers to come into the movie and not being able to pick up who was going to be good and bad. He took inspirations from several famous brother-turned-enemy stories from across action pop culture when creating the arc. Also, as we all know, Orion Pax was a librarian and a scholar, I suppose, while Megatron himself was a gladiator. But they changed it now to those two becoming co-workers in the mines instead. Which I had no problem with that, to be honest. Now, I might not be able to use all of them, but I might have enough for, yeah, maybe just for the main people. Chris Hemsworth, also known as Orion Pax, or now in the future, Optimus Prime, a miner and the eventual leader of the Autobots who transforms into a red and blue Cybertronian truck, and his brother in arms. Now, show me the name of the man who honored Frank Walker well. Show me the man. Looks like it's going to be a little tricky to get his third name on the plaque. I think it was Henry on the second name.
Brian Tyree.
Henry as D-16, who would eventually become known as Megatron. A miner, the eventual leader of the Decepticons, and Orion's best friend, brother-in-arms, turned nemesis, who transforms into a silver Cybertronian tank. Scarlett Johansson, also known as Alita 1. I remember seeing Alita in that series of Transformers that came out on Netflix. She wasn't that bad. A miner and eventually an Autobot who transforms into a Cybertronian motorcycle. Two more to go. Better get to a hurry, blah, blah, blah. Dang. Key gained Michael Key as B-127, also known as Bumblebee, a miner and eventual Autobot scout who transformed into a yellow Cybertronian car. Long story short, this one's different than the other Bumblebees. A little loony. But he means well. And besides, we need bloody comedy in our lives. Reminds me a little bit of Jar Jar, to be honest. But I'm hoping he'll be the actor doesn't get the hate. Who am I kidding? Of course he might, but we will stand with the brother. Just as much as we will stand by this legendary actor. Come on out.
Steve Buscemi.
Remember him? Randall? Monster House? Remember that man? God, that guy was a good actor. A legendary actor. That Starscream. The leader of the Cybertronian High Guard and eventually a Decepticon lieutenant or second in command who transformed into Cybertronian Jet. Now, two to go. Another legend among us.
Lawrence Fishburne.
So many characters he has done, so many I'm lost count. And this man played as Alpha Trion, an ancient sage who transforms into a robotic beast and is the keeper of the ancient Primus Cogs. He is also one of the Primes themselves, but I don't know. Josh Hammond, also known as Sentinel Prime, the ruler of Cybertron who secretly worked for the Crimsars. Trust me, finding out about, I can't say I'm surprised, especially from my previous experience with the other one. Now, normally I get the review box, but I'll get to that in a moment. But I also decided to show a musical person. We found out about who the musical man was. And honestly, I'm surprised to see him again after all this time. Reveal thy name.
Brian Tyler.
Yeah, I should have probably said it myself. Brian Tyler. A fantastic musician. The man who has done works in The Fast and the Furious, Rambo, The Expendable Trilogy, Iron Man 3, Avengers, Age of Ultron. He also did work with Danny Elfman, but he was also iconic works, was in Transformers Prime. It's an honor to have him back. Let's see. It premiered Transformers 1 in Sydney, Australia on September 11th of November of this year and was released by Paramount Pictures in the United States on December 20th. By when it came out in my country, in the UK, October 11th. That's why this review took long. Yeah. The film received positive reviews from critics who praised the story, animation, and voice performance, but underperformed at the box office, grossing over $113.3 million worldwide, possibly falling short of its break-even point. Oh well. But honestly, this movie, it became the one we deserve to many, even if it's not the one we needed to some. But honestly, I enjoyed the hell out of that movie. It was definitely different from what I remember from the origins of Optimus and Megatron. And honestly, it was impressive. And the actors and actresses, they played wonderfully. And honestly, I loved those guys. Trusted them just as much as anyone. Which is exactly why I give them a 10 out of 10 performance. But But alas, we don't put that on review on movies. So, in my opinion, I was going to say 7.5 out of 10, but now maybe 8 out of 10, or maybe that original number. How about this? 7.5 out of 10, or 8 out of 10, just for the performance, music, and the story. And what's better, no humans were involved. No, really, there was actually no human allies. It was actually showing the origins of history, which is all something we all enjoy. And you were right, Sonic Primal. It was one hell of a show, and I'm truly grateful for your post. And I recommend it to all in the audience. Well, looks like it's about time to call it a night. See you around. I have spoken.